Zenject is based on an important design principle that falls under the umbrella of inversion of control, called dependency inversion. The idea is that classes shouldn't be responsible for locating their own dependencies. That responsibility belongs to someone else. In our case, that someone else is Zenject. This is great because it allows us to write code that is completely decoupled. Class A doesn't need to know about class B. They can both be written and tested in complete isolation. But what happens when class A suddenly needs to communicate with class B?
Traditionally, there are two approaches to this problem. The first is to have class A call a method on class B. And the second is to have class B listen and react to an event that is raised by class A. Method 1 requires us to pass an instance of B into class A, which tightly couples the two classes together. And method 2 requires us to pass an instance of A into class B, which also tightly couples the two classes together. So how should two decoupled classes communicate? One extremely popular method is to introduce an object that both class A and class B interact with. This intermediary object is responsible for both maintaining and notifying a list of objects that are listening to it. If you're sitting there thinking, "Wait a minute, isn't this just another flavor of the observer pattern?" Well, then go ahead and give yourself a pat on the back. The observer pattern is a design pattern in which an object, called the subject, maintains a list of dependents, called observers, and notifies them automatically of any state changes, usually by calling one of their methods. Zenject implements this pattern as a feature called signals. Let's switch on over to the IDE and see them in action. For our example, we're going to be using a very simple implementation of player health. When the player's health changes, we want the UI to be able to react, but we don't want the UI classes to know anything about the player class, and vice versa. I've created this debug UI mono behavior so we can exercise our classes easily in play mode within the editor. It exposes two buttons. The first is display combat text. This calls create on the combat text factory, which basically just creates a nice scrolling text effect. It also exposes another button called heal player. This calls the heal method on player. Player exposes two methods, heal and damage, and it also keeps track of an internal representation of its own health. Let's switch on over to the editor and see this in action. When I click display combat text, we can see that effect that I described before. And when we click heal player, we can see that a message has been added to the console. Internally, health is being affected, but for the sake of debugging, I've just console logged the effect. Now we can take a look at the player class. Like I mentioned before, player manages its own health. It has two methods, heal and damage, which both have an effect on health by calling health.increase and health.decrease, and they also both log to the debug console. It's within these two methods that we need to provide some sort of hook that will allow UI elements and really anything to listen to these events and react accordingly. But before we do that, let's just take a quick look at the game installer. You should be familiar with how game installers work. Currently, this installer binds the player as a single with the arguments 10 and 100. That's 10 current health and 100 maximum health for the player. And it also binds a combat text factory as a single with the arguments combat text prefab and the canvas where these elements will go. Pretty basic stuff. Now, in order for the player to communicate with the UI elements, we need to add some sort of intermediary object that can handle that communication. In the case of Zenject, this is called a signal. We're going to create a new signal class now. Let's switch on over to the editor again. I've created a signals folder to stay organized. Let's create a new C# script and call it player healed signal. The naming convention is the object being affected and then the event in past tense. In our case, player healed signal. All our signal class has to do is inherit from Zenject's signal class and pass itself as a generic argument. Now that we have our signal, we can add it to the player class. Let's add it as a private member variable. And the naming convention here is on player healed. And of course, we'll initialize it from the constructor. Okay. Now we can call it from the heal method. We'll do this by saying onPlayerHeal.fire. All right, we're almost there, but now we need to add this to our installer so that Zenject knows how to inject the new player healed signal. Signals are bound a little bit differently than we've been doing it. Instead of calling container.bind, we call container.declareSignal and pass in the signal as a generic argument. All right, now Zenject knows how to inject the player healed signal into the player class. And the player is now firing it whenever it gets healed. But nobody's listening to it yet. One of the easiest ways to do this, and the way that I recommend, is to add a binding statement for the signal. By calling to, you're describing what is listening and what happens when the player signal, healed signal gets fired. In our case, we're going to use what's called a static binding, which means we don't identify any particular class that's listening. In this case, all we do is call debug.log on player healed fired. All right, so we've declared our signal and we've declared a single listener. Let's see it in action. If you'll recall from previous episodes, we're going to want to hit Edit, Zenject, and then Validate, then Run, or Control-Shift-R. This will validate the scene and ensure that everything is hooked up correctly, and then run the app. Okay, the scene was validated and it ran. Let's click Heal Player. Sure enough, we have our original statement and now our new OnPlayerHealedFire statement in the console. But we're going to need more information than that. We want to know how much was healed. That way we can spawn a new floating combat text. So let's add an argument to the signal. So now let's navigate to the player healed signal class. And we're going to want to add more generic arguments, one for each argument we want to pass. In this case, we just want a single int that represents the amount healed. This needs to be called on fire. So we're going to need to update the player class. Let's do that now. We can see that there's an error in the fire. So let's pass the amount healed onto that. And there'll be one more error in the game installer class. Our bind signals now expect the argument type, which we'll pass in the generic arguments of bind signal. And of course, the lambda also expects the int as well. Now we can update our debug statement to include the value. All right, let's see it in action. Again, I'll click Control-Shift-R so that it'll validate and then run. Now we'll click Heal Player, and we can see that we're passing in the value on the console debug message. I think it's time to display some combat text. We're going to need to add a new bind signal. But this time, it's going to be an instance type binding, which means we're going to pass in bind text factory. Now, the lambda expects a whole new signature. It's going to expect the combat text factory and the int, which we'll call healed. We can call factory.create and pass in our string. With arguments to make sure that the class is injected properly. And that should be enough. There you have it, a very simple implementation. But you can hopefully see the power behind this. Now, we can hook this into all sorts of events. We can have particle systems fire whenever someone's healed. We could have a health bar actively watching the on-player healed event and updating itself appropriately. And we could play sound bites whenever the player gets healed as well. The possibilities are endless. And not limited to UI. I'd like to challenge you to finish the code example by writing the player damage signal. You could scrub through this video and reverse engineer the code, but where's the fun in that? For $5 on Patreon, you get access to all the code used in my videos and show a little support at the same time. If you like this video, please leave a like and a comment letting me know what you thought. And for more Unity tutorials just like this one, please subscribe with notifications on. Thank you to all my supporters on Patreon, and a special shout out to Rstar, Yakov, and Dilio.